Good morning, Colin.
Good morning.
So, I'm Wellington Ekaya. I'm going to make this presentation on behalf of the BecA-ILRI Hub, and it's a real privilege to do that. And thank you, Jace, for the nice introduction. So, in terms of what I will be talking about, that is the outline. I'll give a brief introductory remarks. Set the pitch in terms of what the BecA-ILRI Hub capacity building program is responding to, that is the bigger picture. Come down to specifics, what are the objectives of the program? Talk quite a bit on the Africa Biosciences Challenge Fund, which is the brand name of the program as well as the delivery mechanism. I'll go through some highlights of outputs. Imagine outcomes. They are calling them highlights because we can talk about this in various forms for quite a long time. Look a bit into the future in terms of program growth or scale out strategy, or how are we framing the future given what we have done so far. And then, of course, I must acknowledge various people, including the 40 or so research scientists from the NAS who are sitting as ministers. Thank you very much. So let me just start by saying that the BecA-ILRI Hub, or whatever the BecA-ILRI Hub is doing, was set up under the AU NEPAD, or Africa Union NEPAD, Africa Biosciences Initiative, which created four centers of excellence. BecA-ILRI Hub being one of them, focusing on Eastern and Central Africa for all the work that it does. There are three other centers which we know about. Today is not the day to talk about that. So we are going to focus on BecA and how it was eventually hosted within ILRI. It became a co-creation of ILRI and AU NEPAD. So that history is there. It's available on the internet. You can read about it. So the big question is, what is the BecA capacity building program responding to? What is the bigger issue out there, and what is it contributing to? I chose four main bullets. Cutting across at the NAS, because that is the main area of focus. The issue of low critical mass of NAS scientists in biosciences research. Of course, that we know. You go to any institution, university, you'll be told there's one professor in this, there's one expert in this, and it's the only one, or she's the only one in this part of the region. So the critical mass is really low. Secondly, the issue of weak or ineffective links and partnerships. Again, that is a real pressing issue among our NAS. The issue of partnerships, working together. There's the famous Lone Ranger approach, people trying to work by themselves. So again, that is something to address, because if we don't, then we may not move far with whatever investments that we have. The other big issue is the weak research infrastructure. When I talk of infrastructure here, from our perspective, there's a big focus on the labs or the research environment around the labs. Again, that is one issue we respond to. Then there's the issue of opportunities to effectively leverage advances in biosciences for agricultural research for development. The issue of leveraging is important because institutions need to work together. There are various opportunities. They present various comparative advantages. So these have to be coordinated and leveraged upon if we are to make any headway. Now, looking at that as a bigger picture, I'm sure many of you have read the many assessments carried out by FARA continentally to do with the NAS, carried out by sub-regional organizations like ASAREKA. So all that bigger picture really frames what we are responding to. And all these issues, we are contributing to CADAP agenda, the Comprehensive African Agricultural Development Program agenda, and more specifically, down more to our level, the science agenda for agriculture in Africa, which I'm sure we are all familiar with. So that is the bigger picture, that whatever little that we do, that contributes to this bigger picture. Coming to specifics then, our capacity building program, what are the objectives? One, we are looking at strengthening capacity of NAS to harness latest bioscience technologies to improve agriculture in Africa. Technology is always changing. I always give this story of my experience at the university. There was one professor who shall remain unnamed, was very hardworking, but he had to plant a certain crop for over 15 years, just trying to change the size of the seed, the color of the seed, the taste. But now technology is changing. With the facilities that we have, some of these processes can be done within 6 months or so. Secondly, we want to support NAS scientists' efforts to lead and sustain bioscience research for development in Africa. So the issue here is, like if you read the science agenda for agriculture in Africa, there is a statement, I think science, to outsource science for agricultural development in Africa is very expensive. So we need our own research leaders within the NAS. Thirdly, to promote access to world-class research facilities at the BecA-ILRI Hub and other places as well. And number four, very important, to mobilize capacities in African NAS and beyond for joint action for improving agriculture. Of course, as I said, these national institutions, be they universities, research institutions, ministries of agriculture, you will have various capacities, various expertise dotted around Africa. So one of the objectives is how do we mobilize this, how do we bring them together to leverage in order to get a bigger gain out of that. Our capacity building program, as I said, is branded the Africa Biosciences Challenge Fund, and that is the main delivery mechanism. So under that, it's implemented in four streams. The first stream, what we call the research fellowships, or the ABCS research fellowships. So these are basically research placements that we send out calls and invite applications, and we get research scientists from the national programs who are already running their research, addressing national priorities, but then they have a limitation of either facilities or expertise. Therefore, they come to BecA-ILRI Hub to conduct part of that research at the hub. The program is big, the process is quite long, but in there are some strategies. We are aware of the less resource NAS, countries coming out of conflict, the women representation, women in science or research, issues of sustainability. So all those are ingrained in there. So these fellows, or the research fellows, come to BecA-ILRI Hub for up to 12 months. Right now, I think we have 41 of them seated right behind you there, listening to me very attentively, which is good. So these research fellowships, as I say, they are addressing national priorities. So once they are done with their research, then they go back, take their results back to the national programs to inject into the national outputs. The second stream is training workshops, which I'll talk about in brief. Thirdly, we have institutional capacity building, again, focusing more on the research infrastructure, particularly the labs. And then the fourth component is the issue of providing a platform or a magnet for joint actions by NAS. We act as a magnet, bringing NAS together for joint actions. Could it be, whether it is resource mobilization, whether it is putting together ideas for proposals, for research. Again, I'll mention that a bit later on. So as I said, we have research placements who come to BecA-ILRI Hub. Now, when they come, it's not that they are just coming to get the bench space, sit there, do their business, and go back. That is not the thing. The program is framed in a whole supervision, stroke mentorship, suite of activities. So when they come, they have they interact with full-time BecA Hub scientists and research associates in terms of taking them through what they have to do, learning new techniques, advising them, and all that. There is the BecA Hub extended faculty. These are partners we work with from other international institutions, from other universities who are here or elsewhere. They also benefit from that expertise. Now, this could be visiting scientists. We also have visiting scientists from international research institutions. I think we have Tilly is right there from the John Innes Center. She has been very instrumental in contributing to this program. Even other fellows who come in under the same program, they contribute greatly to the program and to mentorship of other less senior fellows. We have Professor Sheila Okoth seated right here, the lady in red, who has been my colleague for many, many years. I remember way back in 1992 when we started our PhD together, her office was opposite mine. And all she had, I think, was a few microscopes and all that kind of thing. But with time, she has benefited. She's now a distinguished researcher, and she has mentored quite a number of fellows, contributed to the building of the nutrition and aflatoxin platform, and changed quite a number of things. So we are grateful for that. And then, of course, there are scientists from ILRI Biosciences and other departments. All those constitute our extended faculty. We have mentorship, peer review, weekly and invited guest seminars. Every Friday, we have seminars before coming for the Friday coffee. There's emphasis always on the hands-on and passing on the skills from what is done or what is known at the BecA-ILRI Hub and ILRI in general to the fellows who come so that the same can be transferred as much as possible to the home institution. And then recently, of course, many of you know that we always have so many lab tours interacting with donors and all that. So some of the questions, one of the key questions that came up was, well, these people come here, they have a nice facility, they have all this support, so what happens when they go back home? So that was a challenge to us. And recently, about two or so months ago, one of my colleagues, Roger, I think Roger is seated right there, has introduced some sort of return to home institution preparatory process. Well, when you are here, you have enzymes that we purchase and everything is in a kit. But then when you go back, then you have to learn how to make your own enzymes and other things and how to adapt this advanced research environment to what you have at home, which is an important aspect of the program. Let me now mention something about the BecA annual workshops. There are demands from the NAS and our partners about short skill enhancement trainings to meet those skill gaps that exist out there that are really locking the potential of the NAS and the scientists. So we have our traditional annual workshops, five of them, the ones you can see there. These workshops are run every year, once every year. We run them here, but it's also possible, and we have done that, to take them to the region. So one institution may request, come and run this workshop in our institution so that more scientists can be trained or more technicians can be trained. And we have done that in a number of institutions. The other aspect that is coming out quite strongly as a demand is tailor-made courses. The university may have researchers or may be working on a new project. They need some new skills just to make them hit the ground running. So we have tailor-made courses like we had for Addis Ababa University recently. So this is just a short curriculum specific for that particular client. Institutional capacity building. As I say, this is around the research environment to try and unlock the potential of the institution to conduct research related capacity building. So in terms of institutional capacity building, there are a number of aspects, mainly four. It could be technical assistance, in lab design, management, equipment installation, which is quite a common challenge. Transfer of technologies following training of scientists who come here. They now go back to the NAS. So how do you assist them to transfer those technologies, some of those technologies and skills? Could it be resource mobilization? Because you can have a good lab or a fairly good lab, but without resources, then you will not move. Then connections to networks and key influencers like suppliers. Sometime this year, we were in Rwanda. The Rwanda Agriculture Board labs, and there was a big issue of suppliers. Where the suppliers are being get reagents. So that also is an aspect that we are really engaged in to try and ameliorate the challenges at the NAS level, so that we can really try to unlock their potential for contributing to the bigger picture, which is the kind of agenda I mentioned. Mobilizing capacities for joint action, again, bringing together the best brains that we have, the best experiences, so that we can coalesce this towards a common journey. One of the main mechanisms has been the Agricultural Research Connection workshops, which started, I think, in 2009. So bringing scientists and research scientists and other experts from all over the world congregating here in Kenya or any other place, just to think together, share experiences, know what is going on, and out of that bloom new ideas. There's what we call the PAPA, Participant Action Plan, which happens to be my nickname in BecA as well. So again here, what happened is that when fellows are leaving, they have to give us at least three activities that they will do, so that one, there is more awareness about BecA. Two, they present about their work. Three, they explore opportunities. They explore opportunities for collaborating with BecA more, or partnering with BecA more, or other institutions, so that, you know, we are really mobilizing capacities. We know, we get to know who is out there, who we can work with, and who can also work with us, so that we build that that platform out there. There is communities of practice. Again, I'll talk a little bit about that, because now we have quite a big forum of alumni out there. So we want to organize them so that we can coalesce and bring that energy and experience and expertise into action. And then the other area is resource mobilization. I put there S because recently there was a call by the World Bank to create African centers of excellence. And BecA acted as a magnet to 15 research consortia from Africa. It was not easy, but we made it. We were able to support them, and the process is still going on. We are hoping that at least we get some of this funded. So having given those highlights, let me now focus a little bit on some of the main achievements, just the highlights in terms of outputs and emerging outcomes. ABCF Research Fellows. So far, we have 226 trained who will have gone through the process by end of 2015. These are drawn from 21 African countries. Now, the research focus is really on the five key themes, or research themes, that frame BecA. So although we may say also that there are those that are in livestock improvement is really big. We're talking about breeding, nutrition, and all those aspects. So it's really broad, but basically we lump them in those five key areas or research themes. Recently we looked at the projects and how they fit into the five themes. So we came up with this pie chart, and we realized that most of the projects lie between livestock, or within livestock research and crop research. So 32% of the research or the projects were looking at livestock research or improvement, 44% in crops research improvement, food safety and nutrition 11%, underutilized species of crops and livestock 6%, climate change 4%. And of course there are others that we would like delving in. These are new areas, interesting areas, areas for the future, medicinal plants, bush meat, bees and all that. So that was a category of others which formed 2%. So in terms of contributing to the BecA-ILRI Hub and the ILRI mission, that is how the picture looks like. Training workshops, we've trained about 556 people, research scientists from 27 countries. Here the female representation is normally greater, it's more than 50%. But going to the fellowships, we normally dangle between 33-35%, for good reason, of course, because we know the issues of women participation in science, women training, where you have to host them, where you have to leave your family and all that. So that is where we are. In terms of publications, total journal papers coming out of BecA at the moment, we have 156. Out of these, 61 are from the ABCF fellows. And we have quite a number of manuscripts coming now. And the program has registered its presence in high-end journals, Science, for example, PLOS, and quite a number of these. And right now, as we sit, everybody's crossing fingers, because recently a paper was submitted to Nature, so we are waiting for the outcome. So that is contribution to science. Communities of practice, as I said, we have quite a large alumni out there, and we are now, as the program grows, we are seeing how we bring these experiences, this expertise together to come up with bigger programs, teach their research within the national programs, and they can always come back to do part of their work in at BecA-ILRI Hub. So we have four nascent communities of practice, really at this stage. There is one on Taro, involving four or so countries. And I'll just ask the steward, we have stewards, somebody taking the lead for these communities of practice. So I'll just ask the steward for Taro COP and she can see you be just for half a minute to mention what is all about, how many countries, and I'll continue from there. So, Dalit, then.
Good afternoon, everyone. All right, my name is Dawit. I'm from the Ethiopian Institute of Agricultural Research. I'm also a PhD student at Queensland University of Technology in Australia. The project on Taro, it started back in 2013 when I was here to do the virus survey projects for samples from Ethiopia. But due to a good contact that I have with supervisor from here in Australia, we discussed and we need to increase the project because the taro or arrowroot is very basic and good source of carbohydrate in the region. So currently we include Uganda, Tanzania, Kenya, and Ethiopia in the whole project. But in early June, July, I was on a field survey in Uganda and Tanzania, and we noticed that virus is not the only problem. There are also bacterial and fungal diseases which are seriously affecting the crop. And I can say it becomes totally orphan, the crop, because of production loss. With my supervisor in Australia, I got a chance to link up with Secretariat of Pacific Community in Fiji. There is a lab called CEPA, called Center for Pacific Crops and Trees. That lab, it has the world's largest collection of taro. And among their collection, they have around 20 to 25 varieties which are moderately and highly resistant to fungal, bacterial, and viral diseases of taro. So when I was on my field trip to Uganda and Tanzania, I discussed with people working on fruit crop at Naro and Mari, and they are very much interested. And then we further communicate with the representative from CEPAC from Fiji, and they are very willing to give us starting materials, tissue culture materials of those resistant, 25 resistant materials, so that we can further multiply in tissue culture and maybe do a kind of field trial in Uganda, Tanzania, and in Kenya. And for that project, we have a representative from Ethiopia, and BecA will be the host for the whole project. That's all.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Christian Gambo Tiambo from the University of Boya in Cameroon. So we are almost working on local chicken development, genetic development. So the work started really in here in 2012 when I came for part of my PhD. And from there, thanks to the capacity building team of BecA, I've been able to gather some other people from different countries, from first Cameroon, then Gabon, Central African Republic, Rwanda, and the other country, Uganda, who are now also working on this local chicken genetic research and development. So we have developed a community of practice. And now we are working not only on genetic itself, but also on nutrition, disease resistance, etc. And I would like to say that it is really down to the capacity building of BecA. And what I will add is that this aspect of capacity building is highly appreciated at the national level. I can take an example. When I was here, in just when I came, a few months after my arrival here, I was appointed as Animal Science Program Coordinator at the University of Boya. So the issue here, the thing here is really appreciated at the higher level from our countries, so that the experience that we are gaining here, we can easily transfer them to our countries and to the neighboring countries. So thank you very much for everything.
Thank you very much. So we have another tool, maize lethal necrosis disease and striga resistance, that is forming. In terms of outcomes, how do we know about this? In 2014, the program underwent an external review by Dalba Consultants that gave us a lot of information These kind of testimonies by our alumni are very important. We talk to our partners, what they are saying, we gather all those. And then, of course, our own experiences as BecA staff, BecA scientists, and people managing the program, all that feeds into some of the things we call outcome. So this is an excerpt from our report in terms of how we are meeting our objectives. Well, the scores, we could do with a bit of improvement, but they are not that bad. So basically, the message is there's very strong endorsement by the stakeholders of the program. There's ABCF contribution to downstream impact. Gulu University, as you know, is one of those universities, really, in northern Uganda, where there has been a lot of work for quite some a number of years. We did some lab improvement last year, and the process started much earlier on. Some months back, my colleague, Josephine and Osaso sent out a brief questionnaire just asking, well, we did some work at your institution, so how did it help? What difference did it make? And we received this statement, which I will read from the Gulu University, and it says, we are now using our own lab for research, mentoring and training of 7 MSc and PhD students that we would previously send out to Makerere University and abroad. So that is a statement from the Gulu University. And then also Central Veterinary Research Laboratories, we trained one of the researchers from there. I will not ask the boss or the head of virology who is here, Jane Gidinyi, to talk, but she tells me that because of that training, they are doing things differently, they have extra capacity, they have learned new tools. In Sudan, we have strike-resistant sorghum varieties released. And of course, there's increased awareness about BecA-ILRI Hub. And also, it's a source of pride for all of us. I remember how much time we spent with journalists from Germany last Sunday with Shani and group. And the journalists were talking nice things, which is always good. In terms of looking forward, or the next pitch for the program, well, I've talked about communities of practice, harnessing the alumni. We must link to universities' policy, you know, some of these information findings getting into policy and university curricula, engaging national councils for science and technology, strengthening linkages with intermediary organizations that can translate some of the findings into policy. We are discussing very seriously with ISA just down the road, the International Service for the Acquisition of Agri-Biotech Applications, to help us do this. Whatever we are doing, we can't do it alone. We have a huge suite of partners. I could not put all of them there, but they are all appreciated. They are part of the process. We learn a lot from them. They support us a lot. So we appreciate them. From the resource envelope side of things and supporting side of things, we appreciate our investors, or the BecA investors, very, very much. Without them, we cannot do much. So a big clap for them after this, and we really, really appreciate it. So having said that, I think that is the end of my presentation, but let me just say that capacity building, BecA operates like a three-legged stool. There's capacity building, there's research and technology. So this presentation is normally much bigger, and then after this, there's my colleague from the technology side who presents, and research who presents, but then because of time and the focus of the discussion, we'll not be able to do that. Thank you very much.